There we go. Welcome to the Digital Trekker.
I see.
We are live. I am Matt, and we are on the Fuji stream, and we have a great, great lineup tonight. We have a wonderful guest, someone I met, well, not personally, but I mean, met over Skype, I guess it was, about almost 10 years ago. And did an interview with him then. And so we're going to ask you to get your questions ready. You're going to be talking to Zack Arias. And we're going to be talking about the Fuji X100V, his experience with that. And we're going to do all of that right after. Okay, so we are back. We've started. We had a little bit of a freak out moment there as we were getting ready to get Skype going and getting everything, all the windows. I've got so much going on. I mean, you got to see this setup I've got here. Look at this. This is my setup. I've got,
wow.
I've got stuff. But there's, you know, you get too much stuff, you know, and so once you get too much stuff, then it gets too confusing. So.
A lot of moving parts right there.
Well, yeah. So welcome, Zack Arias. You are here. You're on. Zack is in Atlanta, Georgia right now. And, of course we are in Penang and talking to him, over Skype and on Facebook. And we are so glad everybody's here with us tonight. If you have questions throughout the night, just put them in the comments on the, Fujifilm, live feed as you obviously are watching, if you are watching right now. And we'll try to get to those questions to Zack as we progress through the evening. And so I want to just take a moment and just say thank you so much, Zack, for taking time out and joining us and being here with us. It's been, I know it's been a crazy time for all of us. Yeah. And so for you, have you been able to do any work these days? I mean, what kind of stuff has been happening with you?
My last real good job was in February, and then I had work lining up for March and April. I usually don't know what I'm doing 30 to 60 days out. I get lots of, hey, where can you be in 2 weeks kind of phone calls. And it's rare for me to have any advanced warning on jobs further than maybe 30 days. So we started rolling into March. I had some jobs on the books. And, you know, there was a lot of talk about coronavirus going around. And we were all kind of wondering, and I remember on March 13th, just the amount of talk on the news and people talking about it on social media. And I had, I have a good friend in Northern Italy, and I've been watching what her experience was because they were already locked down.
Yeah.
And I remember it was Friday, March 13th, and I just had this gut feeling like, I bet everything is about to shut down. And I needed a haircut. excuse me, it's like 8 in the morning here and I'm still waking up. I needed a haircut, so I stopped by the barbershop and I walked in the barbershop. It was packed. Mm-hmm. And there was this little kid sitting in the waiting area just coughing. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to wait on that haircut. And I have yet...
My word. Well, you answered one of my questions, and if you actually have hair under your hat, you know, I don't. Yes. I mean, it's nothing. So
I'm starting to match you. I'm getting there. By that next week, the kids' schools were closed down. They said, you know, it's going to be closed for maybe 2 weeks.
Yeah.
One job canceled, and then it just snowballed. And so I've only had one commercial job since lockdown in March, and that was just a few weeks ago. And we've got some pictures pulled up for that. So, you know, my experience with the X100V, I got one trip out of it and one commercial job, which is far less than what I would normally be shooting with that camera. But here we are.
I think this is a good jumping off spot right now. So why don't you tell us maybe your history with maybe Fuji in general and the X100V in particular? Can you do that?
Sure. I could talk for days on that. how it started with me with the X100 was I've always wanted a smaller camera to just carry around with on a daily basis, or if I travel somewhere and I want to just walk around and take some pictures, I wanted something better than my phone. And I remember I had a trip to Florence, Italy, and I took a 5D Mark II battery grip, 24-70 2.8, a couple primes, and I barely took any pictures with that DSLR because I packed up a bag and just walking the streets for 8 or 10 hours a day with all that stuff was just kind of a pain. And so by day two, I just left it at the apartment we were renting and took pictures on my phone. Mm-hmm. So sorry, that's my dog. It's his time to get up and talk to the neighbors and bark at everyone. Welcome to quarantine, y'all.
It's all right. We're in lockdown. So
right.
There's excuse. Wow. Give that dog a mic. He's got opinions. We need to hear them.
Yeah. So, sorry about that.
That's all right. Go ahead.
So I went through several different point and shoot cameras in my life and never was really happy with them because I wanted a nice print quality. And I was teaching a workshop in San Francisco, and this guy had this beautiful little camera on his side. And I was like, what is that? And he's like, oh, this is brand new Fuji X100. It just came out. It's a little quirky, but it's a cool camera. So he let me shoot with that for the day. And the very next morning, I ordered one. So that was the very first X100 with the very first firmware. And it was a quirky, pain in the butt camera. Like it you would cuss at the thing, but I loved it. And so I did a blog post about it. And I was teaching at Gulf Photo Plus coming up in a few months. And Gulf Photo Plus reached out and said, hey, we're starting to work with Fuji. They've got another camera coming out. And we're pitching them the idea of doing a promo video with you about it, since you love the Fuji camera so much. And they got this new one, and that was going to be the X-Pro1. You know, we've got a little bit of a budget. What do you think about going to Istanbul? I was like, yeah, absolutely. Let's go to Istanbul. So that was the beginning of working with Fuji. And they have been the best people I've ever worked with in this industry. You know, I don't call myself like an official ambassador of Fuji, though I've worked with them off and on for 7 years. And what I love about them is I've never had to sign like weird agreements. I know people who do, you know, ambassador programs for other brands, and they have to do X number of social media posts per month. They have to, you know, put X amount of banners on their websites and hashtags in their profiles. And, you know, they can't ever, ever mention another camera brand name ever, ever. And Fuji's just always let me be me. They give me a camera and they say, go do whatever you want. And they don't edit my thoughts on it. And I'm free to use any camera in the world that I want to use. And So I've always appreciated that about them. So in November of last year, back in the innocent times of Earth, I get an email and they're like, "Hey Zach, all right, we got number five coming out. We got the X100V. We'd love to send it to you. Have you shoot some pictures? Maybe do a promo video." And I was super excited. So in December, I get the camera, or right at the end of November, beginning of December, the camera arrives. And it just comes in a box. Like, I don't have the manual. I don't know, like, even what the upgrades are. Like, I don't know the specs of the camera. I'm like, okay, so what do I need to know about this? And I think it was about 2 days I had the camera, and I went to the rumor sites to see what they were thinking the upgrades would be. And this is the funniest thing to me. So I had this camera for like 2 days, and it was only after reading a rumors site that I realized it had a flip screen. Like, it is so well integrated into the body. I didn't even notice the little tab.
I know.
And I did not think it had a flip screen. And when I went like that, I was like, oh, wow. Like, oh, that's amazing. Hold on. I'm going to get my dog in and shut the door.
All right. Well, while you do that, I'm going to actually show people the flip screen here. So here's this is the camera we're talking about. This is the X100V. And there's the flip screen. Let's see if I can lighten up the picture a little bit. Oh, wrong way. You'd think I'd know how to do it. So there's the flip screen on that.
Yeah.
And now it doesn't really go down. I mean, I guess that's enough for overhead shots, you know. Wait, I gotta keep losing the picture. There you go. I guess that's enough for overhead type shots. Mm-hmm. But it goes flat this way, and it's great for waist level shooting. And
yes.
Absolutely.
I've had to completely retrain my brain to remember that it has that screen. And so I had Fuji gave me two deadlines. One was about around December 20th. They needed photos from the camera, and then somewhere around January 15th, I think, they needed the final promo video. Mm-hmm. So I was racking my brain, and again, they're just like, "Zach, go do whatever you want," which is great. But when you don't have any ideas, that kind of is bad too, because, you know, now you got to figure something out from nothing. Mm-hmm. And I was trying a few different setups. I was trying to get a few different people involved, but it was middle of December. It's the holidays around here. Everyone was busy or out of town or not really working or whatever. And sorry, there's yard work.
That's all right. I can't hear it, actually. So at least I can't.
About that. I think about that poor BBC correspondent who had his kid walk in the back that few years ago. So I was trying to put this video together, and it was just at best mediocre.
This is the promotional video they wanted you to do.
The promotional video for the camera. Mm-hmm. And I sent them pictures, and they were happy with the pictures I sent them. And about first week of January, they're like, "All right, Zach, you know, how's that promo video coming along?" And I was like, you know, like, not great, to be honest. Like, I'm not happy with this. But I knew I was going to Cuba at the end of the month. I was leading a workshop down there in Havana. And I said, if I could have, like, till the end of January for this, I think I can shoot a video in Havana, and that's going to be way, 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 way better than what I'm doing here in Atlanta right now. And they gave me the green light, gave me the thumbs up, said, "Please take it to Havana. You know, let's see what you can do with it." And so, yeah, went to Havana, and the the way I travel now, unless I'm working on a specific assignment or a commercial editorial job that has certain requirements, if I'm simply traveling or spending a day or two doing street photography or anything like that, I only take my X100 now. So when I went to Cuba, I took the X100V and I took an X100T just as a backup in case something happened. You know, this one doesn't even have a serial number on it. So, but I took a backup X100T, and that was the only two cameras aside from my phone that I took to Havana for 8 days.
Of course, a backup and wouldn't have helped you
too much. I love traveling that way.
I was going to say the T wouldn't have helped you too much. I mean, you could take pictures, but you couldn't do the review of the V if something happened to it.
Right, right. Yeah. But I was also leading a, you know, a group of photographers.
I thought you were going out just to do the video.
Yeah. But it has performed flawlessly for me. It is, that new lens is just sharp as a tack. And the focus is fantastic. You know, just everything is refined again. How Fuji does things. They improve, they make things better, they work on this, they work on that, and they just keep plugging away. Refining and refining and refining and refining. And it's just a beautiful little camera. And it's just a joy to travel with.
Hey, I got a question that was brought in over email. And the guy said his name is Simon Labor. And he says, a quick question for Zach. Do you think going, and this is I wanted to say this now because this relates to what you were just talking about. Do you think going totally mobile is a crazy thing? I ditched all my heavy kit when the original X100 turned up, and now I've bought two X100Vs and use an iPad for editing. I'm only doing photography for me. I don't have to please anyone else. Shoot quick edit in the cafe and back shooting again, catching the world again. That's from a guy named Simon Labor. What do you think about his technique there?
I absolutely love that. I wish I could run my whole entire commercial life off the back of an X100 with two converter lenses and maybe a small bag of lighting, right? But, you know, in the commercial world, you have to have all the tools you need. But
right.
Specifically that, when I travel, I have my X100. I take an Instax printer. We can talk about Instax printing if we want. And then I take either my phone or an iPad. And absolutely that. I love to, when I travel to a city and I'm there just to, you know, see the place and experience it, I will, regularly, you know, walk 30 to 40,000 steps a day. I like to get up in the morning, get some coffee, and hit the streets. And I love it when people with leaf blowers are right outside my window. Should be any second now.
Going light.
I'll hang out, go shoot, and then, you know, take a break and hit the cafe, get another cup of coffee, and pull out my phone or my iPad, Wi-Fi transfer images over to it. I love editing in Snapseed.
Me too.
Just deliver pictures out of Snapseed.
Thank you.
That would make me happy.
I'm glad you said that, because I feel like such a novice or something when I'm editing on Snapseed, because I love Snapseed. And the funny thing is, sometimes I can get stuff out of Snapseed that I can't get out of Lightroom. And I'm like, I want to get the picture that I did in Snapseed, and I can't get it in Lightroom.
Exactly. There. I don't know what it is about Snapseed.
It's got voodoo in it.
But there's just something to it. its biggest Achilles heel is that you can't batch process, right? You can apply last edits to a photo, but right, you can't select, yeah. right? I want to edit this and I want to apply this to 10 other pictures.
Right.
Like Lightroom. I've just started in the last month playing around with Lightroom Mobile on the iPad. I'd never really gotten into it. I didn't really have much need for it. But my main laptop recently died and I had to get a job out, this job that we can talk about today. Had to get it done, had to get it out. So I did it on the iPad and it was a learning curve. I'm still not comfortable with it, but you know, I was able to deliver. I think the final count of final edit was 400 something pictures that I took care of all in Lightroom on an iPad. So yeah, being a mobile photographer with a small camera and an iPad or a tablet or phone, I love it.
Hey, I got two more little comments here. I want to touch them and then we can get into the pictures that you sent over to me. John Lowe, whoa, that's big. Let me make that a little smaller. John Lowe wrote and he said, Zach followed your work for many years. Oh, come on, get back here. Put it back up there. Followed your work for many years. Thank you for the inspiration. I know your work through the honest video you did. And that's that video that you did. Was it Transcend? Is that what was it?
Transformed.
Yeah. How significant was that video for your career?
Very significant. Kind of for my life at that point and my career.
Maybe let's back up and give people some little history as to what it is.
So the video, I'll give you a really quick full story. I'm sitting in my studio in Atlanta one day and I get this phone call from a lady named Lynn and she says, "Hi Lynn, my name is Lynn," or "Hi Zach, my name's Lynn." And, I was given your name by Mark Adams. Mark Adams is a photographer in Atlanta, a friend of mine. And he said you'd be a great assistant for this job we have coming up in Atlanta. And I was like, that son of a gun, Mark, he's playing a joke on me because I'm not an assistant. I'm a photographer, right? Like I did my years assisting. I don't assist anymore. And so this must be a joke. So I'm like, "Oh, Lynn, I'm sorry. There must be some miscommunication. I don't assist any longer, but tell me about your job and I'll be happy to find someone for you." And she said, "Okay, well, Joe McNally is coming to town and is doing that assignment, blah, blah, blah." And I'm like, wait, Joe McNally, like National Geographic Joe McNally? And I was like, she's like, "Yes, it's National Geographic Joe McNally." And I was like, my calendar suddenly cleared up and I'm an assistant again.
Exactly.
Right? Like, yeah, absolutely. And she starts laughing and I'm like, "I bet this happens to you a lot, doesn't it?" And she's like, "All the time." I'm trying to
That's all right.
It's the morning. He's excited. He's that's a morning right. person.
Exactly. Anyway.
So I do this job. I'm second assistant on the job. And his first assistant is a guy named Brad Moore. So I meet Brad on this job. And we all work well together. It was a great, awesome day. And we go on about our lives. And Brad and I stay in touch. And it must have been a year or more later that Brad gets in touch with me and he says, "Hey, I'm working with Scott Kelby now. And I handle his guest blog Wednesdays for his blog. And we'd love to have you, you know, do a blog post." And at this point in my career, I was just on the edges of the photo industry radar. Mm-hmm. I had some workshops that I would do every now and then. I was just putting out my first One Light DVD. I was active on forums, but I wasn't out there as a name in the photo industry at all. And so they were like, you know, you can do a blog post about anything you want. You can do it about lighting. You can talk about your workshops. You can do this. You can do that. Let me take care of my dog.
Sorry. The joys of live broadcasting.
Doing it live, people. All right. So short story, I was in like a trough of depression in my life. My father was at the end of his life. He was in hospice care at this point. I didn't want to do a blog post about softboxes. Like, I didn't know what I wanted to write about. So I went through Kelby's blog and I looked at all the guest posts that have been done. And, you know, they're about this and about this lens and how to photograph animals at a park. And Chris Orwig had a really good one about burnout. But he had kind of like a good ending to it. Like, and here's some things you can do to get out of burnout. And I'm like, I'm burned out, but I don't have a good ending to this blog post of like how to get out of it, because I'm still in the middle of it. And I had lost my photography career before in the past. And when I had a chance to come back into photography, I made myself a promise that I was always going to be honest with people. And I was going to tell people what I wish I would hear. Because before, I would look out into the industry, and if I was struggling, all the voices coming back to me, everyone was successful, everyone was doing great work, everyone was happy, everyone was getting new camera equipment all the time. It was a fake it till you make it, and, you know, mm-hmm. Never, ever let anyone think you're struggling. Like, always be at the top of your game. You have to show confidence, always. You can't ever show weakness.
Right.
You know, this was like, you know, in the 90s, coming into the 2000s. It was always have your best face forward, always. Mm-hmm. And when I had struggles, there was no one talking to me. There was no one saying, hey, it's tough and I'm struggling too. So I decided, you know, I'm going to be that voice. When people are struggling, I'm going to let them know that, yeah, it's real and you're not alone. So I made that video. I was really kind of afraid to put it out into the world because it did just kind of go off in an emotional ditch. Mm-hmm. I told them, I said, I just want you to put the video up. I don't want you to mention my workshop. I don't want you to mention my DVD. I don't want you to have any links really back to me other than if, like, this is Zack Arias, he's a photographer, here's a link to his work. That's it. And just stick the video up. And, like, it blew up. It was the very first piece of art I think I've ever created, because people started writing back to me telling me, you know, what that video said to them. That was stuff I didn't put into the video, right? But it spoke to them in their life in some other way than what I was saying about my life. So I feel like that's art, you know, that people can look at something and interpret it to how it's personal to them that maybe the artist wasn't intending in the first place. And from that point, I had like 3 book publishers get in touch with me, like, hey, do you want to do a book, you know, about photography or whatever? I got more requests for my workshops. I started getting requests to go to events and expos and do, you know, speak. And assisting Joe McNally led to Brad Moore, led to Scott Kelby, led to you and I talking here today. So.
Yeah, I remember.
Because I got honest.
Yeah, I remember the video, and I remember thinking when I listened to it, it was like it was somewhat depressing in a sense, but there was a sense of at least someone's being honest. You know, it's finally here's an artist who has an artist temperament that's talking about what it's like to be an artist. Because I think those of us that consider ourselves artists, I think we have a lot of self-doubts, a lot of confusion about business, I'm talking about myself. And so when I watched that video, it struck a nerve on, you know, with me. And that's, a moment I think a lot of photographers appreciated from you. And I think it was a significant, event. So thank you for that.
So, yeah.
All right. So now let's talk about these pictures, because they didn't get us to talking all depressing here. So
everyone knows Matt is going to be running the slideshow. I'm not running that from my screen. It's best for him to run it. So
yeah. So
we're going to have to do some audio cues.
But if, that's fine. So are we ready to jump right in to that? We can do that. So here's your first slide.
All right. So this was a job for a company. They're on a small island off the coast of Georgia, the state where I live in the United States. They're called Defuski Blue. And the lady who runs this company makes these scarves and accessories and clothing with indigo. It's this natural dye. So they needed some lifestyle pictures for their new website they're building. And we basically just cast locals that live on the island, people that were friends and all of that. And the only way to get to the island is on a water taxi. Mm-hmm. And I was staying with a dear friend of mine who lives on the island. He's the one who got me the job. And so not only was I going out for the weekend to do the job, but I also did all their grocery shopping. So I had a whole bunch of groceries I had to get to the island, because there's no grocery store on the island, and whatever gear I needed. So I wanted to pack super, super light. So for this job, I took X100V, my X-Pro2. I took the conversion lenses for the X100. And then I took the 50 to 142.8 for the X-Pro2 in case I needed a little bit longer of a reach, or, you know, we still needed to maintain social distancing as we shot. So the 50 to 140 is my social distancing lens now. But you can do a lot still with the X and still stay 6 feet away. So the thing I wanted to mention in this talk today, two little tiny things that don't get talked a lot about the X100 series, is that it has a leaf shutter lens as opposed to a focal plane lens or shutter. Mm-hmm. And it has a built-in three-stop neutral density filter. And if you're into lighting and if you're into on-camera flash, a leaf shutter lens and a built-in ND filter just gives you so many options.
Yeah,
those are gold. So like on my X-Pro2, the X-Pro2, it stops shutter speed at 250th of a second, I think, for syncing with flash. And I regularly will go to 1,000th of a second or faster with the X100 with flash. So this picture that you're looking at right now is the available light photo. It was shot at, I think, F2 or 2.5. I don't have the EXIF data in front of me, of course. And about 500th of a second. But you can see that, like, it's dark under the brim of his hat. Mm-hmm. I was wanting to maintain some of the detail in the sky, even though it was just a really cloudy day. And for this client, I didn't want super dramatic, overly like super, super lit pictures, but I needed flash on these gray days to give a little fill. So let's go to the next picture. Yeah. So I was able to bring my ambient down just a little bit more. This was probably getting maybe 800th of a second on the shutter speed. And then just popping that flash in, it was a 120 centimeter octa. And I was running it with a Fotix Indra 500 watt second strobe.
Wow.
But when you're shooting at like F2, F2.8, ISO 200-ish range, you don't need a lot of light. I probably could have just done the job with a hot shoe flash. I rarely needed anything above about 30 second power off of that strobe. So a hot shoe flash could have probably done the job. I took the strobe just in case, you know, I run into something where I needed more light.
I was going to say.
And it worked out really well.
Well, so you used a 120 centimeter octa. That's going to give nice light all up and down him on that. So, mm-hmm. But that also, if you would have used a speed light, that would have sucked up several stops of that, wouldn't it?
Yeah, most likely. But, you know, I probably would have been running like quarter to half power on the speed light. I find that when I get above quarter power on a speed light, then I start going through batteries a lot faster. When I get in that half power, full power range, I just kind of want to point out that with the X100 and this modifier I was using, this could have been achieved with a hot shoe flash.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like,
sure.
You'd be at the higher end power of a hot shoe flash, the lower end power of your, you know, strobe. So if we can go to the next one, we have a side by side comparison here. So the picture on the left is just the ambient light with no flash. And then the picture on the right includes the flash. This was shot at ISO 200 at 2.5 at 1,000th of a second. And that's just something I could not have done with, you know, my focal plane shutter cameras. So it's the X100 definitely has a place in my bag, even on commercial jobs, simply because it has a leaf shutter. Mm-hmm. And it allows me to go to 1,000th of a second or more with flash without any kind of like high speed syncing or TTL or any of that. These are all manual camera settings, manual flash settings. And what's amazing to me is, like, I've always loved the wide angle and the teleconverter adapter lenses. What are they called? The TCL and TCW or something like that?
TCL or W. Oh, sure. WCL and the TCL.
Yes.
One's the wide angle conversion lens and telephoto conversion lens. So
yes.
The wide angle one is equivalent to like 19 millimeter, and the TCL telephoto is like, I think, is that like third? No. Wait, I'm not sure.
In full frame equivalency, you get a 28 millimeter from the wide and a 50 millimeter from the telephoto, if I remember correctly.
I think that's exactly right. Yeah. Oops. Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to put that up, but there it is anyway. So this is one thing about the leaf shutter is that on this camera, you get a maximum shutter speed at F2 of 2,000ths and a maximum shutter speed at 4.5 at 4,000ths. But the cool thing is that you get on the, why is it not working? There we go. The shutter speeds, these are a little thing. Oops, sorry. So that you can sync on using the leaf shutter, you can sync virtually any speed as long as the flash will, given those two little things, right? I mean, several people have asked me, and they've written in to talk to you, and they said, well, you know, the leaf shutter, does that give you you know, what's the sync speed, not how's high speed sync. And the point is on the leaf shutter is because it's a leaf shutter, you don't really have an issue with high speed sync. You're only limited to how fast the shutter can go.
Right. And you're limited to some extent with the flash duration of the strobes you're using. So if you have a slow flash duration, sometimes your camera's shooting faster. With like when I was shooting alien bees, I would start losing the flash at 2/1000th of a second with an X100 because the alien bees have such a slower flash duration. With my Fotix, I can usually get to 2/1000th of a second with no problem.
Have you tried Godox?
After 2/1000th of a second, I'm still catching the flash. But I'm on the like a very short end of whatever that. I'm not the most best technical person in the world to explain that, but
you and me both.
I know that if I'm under 2/1000th of a second, 2/1000th and under, I'm good to go with the X100.
Okay. All right. So let's go back. Here's your pictures. Go ahead. So you want to go to the next one?
We zoom in. You're not seeing the full frame. If we can go to number 4. Yeah. And the improved lens on the X100V I've found so far using the teleconversion lenses has made the conversion lenses even better. The telephoto, I have version 1 of each. I know they've come out with a new version of each one, I believe. But previously, when I would shoot the teleconversion, the teleconverter adapter on the X100 series, I would shoot it 2.8 or smaller because at F2, it just started to, or between F2 and 2.8,
right,
the sharpness would start to fall apart. It'd start to pull back together at 2.8.
Right.
And so I've found with the 50, this was shot at 2 or 2.5. And it's way sharper than if this was had been shot on a previous X100. And again, I'm only talking from my experience of using version 1s of the converter lenses.
I was talking to somebody. I was talking with someone about the converters. He said that the quality of the conversion, the actual quality of the glass and the sharpness and everything are virtually identical between version 1 and version 2. I'm not sure. I think one, and somebody was actually saying that you can actually get good deals on version 1, but the problem is that it and it's a minor problem, is that the camera doesn't recognize it. In other words, it doesn't put it in the EXIF data that you're using it. But the second version does. And so you can the second version, I guess, has, I don't know how it does that. It must have some electronics in it or something, but I thought it just screwed on. But anyway, but somehow it does. And they were saying I haven't used them, but somebody was telling me that because exactly what you just said, because that 2.8 is so much, I mean, that F2 is so much sharper now, that it makes it like you got, you know, another version of the converter lenses.
Yep. Yeah. That's where, you know, I've always thought that X100s were sharp. And, you know, so when I started talking to Fuji about it, they're like, yeah, we've redesigned the lens and it's sharper. I'm like, it's always been sharp. Like, how do you make it sharper? And starting to look at it, I was like, oh yeah, well, I can see where that is sharper. But then I threw that 50 equivalent onto it, shot it at F2 and 2.5 in that range, and it was like, oh, there it is. There's that sharpness, like, really shows up. So this was, you know, just trying to shoot happy little lifestyle pictures of, you know, to show off the scarves and the accessories that this company makes. And I could shoot it wide open, at 1/1000th of a second, with flash. And, it gives you so many different options. Now, what I want to show, let's go to the next slide. I did go ahead and shoot something dramatic because I knew that I would at some point be talking about this camera, and I wanted a couple, like, you know, example photos to show. Mm-hmm. So picture on the far left is available light photo. You're exposing for the subject, and the sky is completely blown out.
Right.
And then the next picture is at like F2 at a thousandth of a second, I believe. I don't have the EXIF data in front of me. Sorry. Anyways, so trying to bring that exposure down, but the sky is still pretty bright. Then you kick on that 3-stop neutral density filter, and like, bam. This is still at F2 to 2.8, thousandth of a second, low ISO. You kick in that ND filter, and you've got, you know, a really dramatic sky. Let's go to the next slide where we go a little more full frame. So what I love about lighting and what I love about like having a leaf shutter is that it gives me visual options. I often talk about exposing the ambient light as seasoning, like you shutter speed to taste. The shutter speed is the predominant thing that you use to control your ambient light. So standing in one spot, throwing on that neutral density filter, bringing that shutter speed up nice and fast, you can just drop that ambient light quickly and then light your subject for something very dramatic. So let's just kind of walk through these pictures.
Okay, you want to go to the next one?
And you could just, yeah.
All right,
and
there you
just
go.
Like
click through.
Cycle, all right. Just click through till we get to the end of her. So standing there, changing my shutter speed settings, and just kind of cycle back to dark and back to light, if you can, Matt. It gives me these options. I can take it really dark, really dramatic, or I can brighten it up so it, you know, isn't quite so dramatic.
Yeah, I like that one.
Yeah, I like living in that kind of range. I think for the client, the client's going to be at this brighter end of the spectrum for what they need.
Yeah.
But that middle ground is where I like to live a lot as well. That
well,
one
it
that
all depends,
mentioned.
I guess, if I guess it depends on if the client wants, like, this girl doesn't look like exact, she needs, you know, kick-ass drama kind of look, you know? I mean, she looks like, hi, right. I'm here from my summer break and I want to be fun and, yep. And she looks fun, you know? And so that looks more fun. This looks like, yep. I'm an off-duty superhero, you know? There's just all this, like, I'm conjuring the sky and I'm going to, you know, yeah. Blow things up because it's just so cool, you know? Yeah. So, Rafael Fernandez says in camera flash, and I'll let you handle that. I think
I rarely, if ever, use the on camera flash of the X100, only if like it's at night and I'm in a bar and I'm just taking pictures of people and there's zero light. So this was
last night. No, I was at a birthday party last night, and we were at an outside birthday party, and they said, "Okay, take your pictures. You had your camera," and I had the X100, and I thought, "Well, there's no light," and it's like, "Okay," and so I used the TTL on it, and then I used slow sync, and I mean, it was obvious. That, as Joe McNally always says, it's that Xerox light, you know, and red eye and everything else. Yep. But I was still amazed at how, I mean, for that kind of stuff, I mean, it pulled it off. But anyway, go ahead now.
Yeah. And this was that 120 centimeter octa. I only took one modifier and one light with me on the job just to stay with a really small kit. So that's how this was lit. The Octa was at camera left, just slightly higher than she is tall and pointing down at her, just outside of the frame. We can go to the next one. There's a girl standing on a dock.
Right there.
And so this is without flash. This is, you know, working out my ambient light. I was at about 1/1000th of a second, I think. I was just a click over 1/1000th of a second on shutter speed. This is with the wide angle adapter on the X100. And then the next picture is dropping in the light.
So did you lean that light over the water?
It was basically over my head, but leaning on the rail so that it wasn't directly coming from the axis of the camera. So it was
like 25 degrees off,
just
or
kind
something.
Of leaning out over the rail a little bit.
Mm-hmm. That's nice.
And then let's go to the next one. Yeah, and again, this is the teleconversion adapter lens, somewhere around f2 to 2.5 with and in the range of 1/1000th of a second, low ISO, 100, 200 ISO. I think the funny thing is remember when Fuji cameras, if you were shooting RAW, you had to be at 200 or higher? There was at some point, and they had a L ISO, a low ISO, which is the equivalent of 100.
Right.
But I think you could only shoot JPEG at that point.
Right.
And so they have fixed that since. I think you can shoot now low in RAW, but it's still in my head that you got to be at 200 to shoot RAW. And I forget that I can always drop to low. I think on this job I remembered I could drop to low. But yeah, I needed to balance the available light with the flash. And again, that leaf shutter lens did it for me. If I would have shot this picture with the X Pro 2, I would have had to go with a smaller aperture to stay in the 250th of a range. So I would have had to shoot this at maybe 5.6 or, you know, getting close to f8. Yeah. Then that background would have all started coming into focus. I wouldn't have had any fall off back there at all.
Did you use the ND on this?
No ND on this.
Okay.
Like as long as I'm rolling a 1/1000th or that range, 1/1000th to 2/1000th of a second on shutter speed, and I'm maintaining all of the ambient light exposure that I need to. Mm-hmm. Then I don't go. Typically, I go to the neutral density filter when I want to bring the drama, when I want to just drop that ambient, make it dark, make it moody, make it really dramatic. But you know, this job really didn't call
for that. I wonder why Fuji doesn't put NDs, built-in NDs in like the X-T4 and such, and the X Pro 3. That would be awesome to have that in there, because you actually need it less probably in the X100, because you've got a leaf shutter than you do in the other cameras. Okay, Fuji.
Right. And you'd really I could really see it with the X-T4 for doing video.
Yeah,
and the
absolutely.
X-H1.
Yeah.
Big having time. Built in. I can't speak to the mechanical engineering of what it would take to do that. I know that the design of the X100 lens and the leaf shutter, like how the shutter and the lens are built from what I've been explained. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, talk to me like I'm a 5-year-old, is that this design made it very easy for them to engineer a filter to drop in and out.
I see.
I would imagine that on the X series, like the Pro and the XTs and all that, you somewhere in that box between the lens and the sensor, you would have to have a sensor-sized ND filter drop in.
Yeah. You'd need space.
The ND filter, from what I understand, is actually in the lens and not so much in the body.
Hmm. Okay.
I may be wrong on that, but.
Well, you know, we got a guy.
Technical people.
Well, Rene Delbar is listening, and he's one of our technical guys, so he can let us know. All right, so shall we go on to the next one? The next one is the same girl.
Yeah, I probably got that out of order just a bit, but you know, for editorial work, like I love this kind of balance. Like I like it a little more dramatic. Mm-hmm. I tend to like this sort of balance between ambient and subject. And like you were saying earlier, you know, if it doesn't really match her, and it sure didn't match the job, but I shot these just so that I'd have some, you know, some pictures to show from the camera.
Yeah.
I'm planning on doing a YouTube video on my channel about it. And then the next one, if you want, click on to the next, number 17. So this is from my trip to Havana. And the hard thing with traveling, and when I went to Havana, I didn't even take the conversion lenses. I usually don't travel with them. I take them if I'm going on a job where
really?
It's going to give me a little more. Because when I travel, the beauty of the X100 and a fixed lens is that you don't have to spend any brain power figuring out what camera you're going to shoot with, what lens you're going to shoot with, you know, what configuration of equipment am I going to put together today to go take pictures. I have an X100, I have a 35 millimeter equivalent lens, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
And of course you get into times when you say, oh, I wish I had a wider lens, or, oh, I wish I had a longer lens. I wish I could compress this picture, or there's something going on further away from me. I wish I had a telephoto to reach it, you know, or, oh, I'm in this place and I wish I had a really wide angle lens. And you know, I get into those places. I'm like, oh man, my 10 to 20 lens would be amazing in here. Or I really wish I had a 50 to 140 right now, because I could like compress all these things and stuff. And, but you don't have those options. So you just have to make it work. Mm-hmm. And you have to zoom with your feet. And, you know, I wanted a wider angle shot of the Malecon. It was amazing weather when I was down there. It was the end of January, which should seasonably be fairly warm, but it was actually seasonably fairly cool. And there were just lots of storms off of the coast that were bringing in these massive waves. And you know, I just make it happen, you know, with whatever I got. So we can continue on. You can just sort of click through.
Well, I was just going to say, for me, if it was me, I think I'd probably put on the wide, the WCL, and just probably leave it on. I tend to shoot wide a lot. And so in the 20, or the 23, right. It's nice, but it's almost, I think I'm looking forward to getting the WCL, because I think I'll enjoy it even more wide. I'll probably end up leaving it on. By the way, that's a stunning picture, though. I love that shot.
Thanks. So, and edited in Snapseed from a JPEG.
This like, one? This particular
all
shot?
All of these are JPEG, all edited in Snapseed on my iPad. Because when I, you know, I didn't have any raw conversion available. You know, you
right.
get a brand new camera that's not out on the market yet.
Right, right.
No one can convert the raws, so you have to shoot raw plus JPEG. So you can just cycle through.
Okay.
Some of these. Cycle slowly through until we get to the black and white picture.
Okay, that's the next one after this. But this is nice.
Oh, stay on this one right here.
Yeah.
So this ballerina.
I said I can stay on it. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sorry.
Oh, apparently there's a little lag in our Skype here. I said yes, I'll definitely stay on this. I think she's beautiful. So.
Yeah. People have said, well, can you use the X100 on a job? And a lot of times people have, you know, an XT series or an X Pro series, but there's this feeling like the X100 is so small and it's so tiny and it's so little, like, can you commercially shoot with it? And you have to remember, like, it's the same sensor. It's the same great optics, you know, that all the other Fuji cameras bring to the table.
Yep.
And what I love about, like, this camera, I didn't take any lighting to Cuba. I wanted to just be, you know, just shoot and not worry about lighting, any of it. And I think, it's just freeing in how good this camera does with ISO, how fast the lens is, how small it is. You can drop shutter speeds pretty low and still get a sharp picture because it's just such a tiny, lightweight camera. The leaf shutter doesn't give you any, you know, shutter shake. And so you can get yourself into whatever, like, low light situations and, you know, just pull it off with a little tiny camera with beautiful results. You know, any point and shoot camera I had tried in the past would not have gotten me this picture. And while I could have taken this picture on my phone, it would look really good on my phone. If I tried to make a large print of it, it wouldn't look anywhere near as good with an X100 print next to it. Okay, so let's click through a few more to the next one. And this is just kind of a fun travel tip.
Yeah, that works.
So if you don't take lights, but need some, everybody has a light now, right?
Right.
Everybody's got a phone in their pocket. Wherever you go in the world, people got a phone in their pocket, and they got a light. And so if there are people around, you can utilize those lights plus your own light. And let's click to the next one.
It's nice.
Yeah. So, you know, you can get some really interesting results just off of cell phones. The other really interesting thing about working with other people in the street, traveling, the more people you get involved in the process, you get their friends involved and you get some other random stranger involved. Like, it just becomes a more interesting and fun kind of experience. Like, so this person you're taking a picture of suddenly has, you know, three or four people standing around them with their cell phones out. And the average person on the street has no idea what this final product you're trying to make looks like. Like, what are you doing? This looks ridiculous. Everyone's kind of laughing. It's always funny for some reason. Like, we all end up just laughing about these things. So I take my pictures and then I pull out the Instax.
Yeah, this baby.
This is the SP3 I have in front of me. And you can not speak a word of the same language to each other. And when that Instax print comes out and it starts to develop and it gets passed around to everyone standing around, like, you are the mayor of town now. Like, anything you need, people will do it for you. These Instax printers have opened so many doors for me. They have bought me drinks. Instax prints have gotten me meals from people. They have gotten me hanging out with people till 4 o'clock in the morning, shutting the city down just because of an Instax print. And I've once stood on a bridge and cried with a lady because of an Instax print. I was in Paris, and I was walking across this bridge. It was I was right next to Notre Dame, and there was a woman standing on this bridge, and she was just standing there looking out at the river and at the city, and she was just kind of casually having a cigarette. And I was like, how more Parisian can you get? Like, there's this lady, she's casually having her cigarette and she's looking out, and it was like the end of the day and the light was really beautiful. And so I just pulled my camera up. I had my X100 and I pulled it up and I took a quick shot of her, just like a quick as I went by. She was completely unaware that I had taken a picture. That's another nice thing about X100. Like, no one pays attention to this camera, right? And it's silent.
Exactly.
So I'm walking across the bridge looking at it, and I make a print of it. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to go back and I'm going to give this lady this picture. Because it felt like she was just lost in a moment. And I liked the picture I had made of her. I thought, ah, that's a cool kind of picture. I like this picture. Let me give her a print of it. So I go back and I'm like, hi, pardon. My name is Zach. And she's like, oh, hi, my name is so-and-so. She spoke beautiful English. And I was like, listen, you know, I'm not trying to be a creep. You know, you have to kind of sometimes explain that I just took your picture, you know, and now I'm going to give you your picture. Like, you can come across creepy pretty quick.
Yes, yes, you
can. Especially like old gray-haired, you know, guy. Yeah. And she's like, you know, mid to late 20s. Like, hi, I took your picture. So I was like, hey, I don't want to creep you out, but I just saw you here having this moment. And it was really beautiful, and the light is beautiful. I never, especially when I'm speaking to women on the street, I never say you are beautiful or you look fantastic, because I think that gets into kind of creepy land. Like, so I always will compliment the light, you know, like the light was beautiful. You have this amazing hat. I love the hat, right? Like, without getting into, wow, you're really beautiful. So I said, you know, I saw you standing here having your smoke, and the light was really beautiful, and I snapped a picture, and I liked how it turned out. Here's a copy. And I hand her the Instax, and she looks at it and she starts to cry. And like, I sometimes cry when I tell a story, and I'm like, oh God, what have I gotten myself into? Like, this woman's now crying. What have I done?
Right.
I'm like, oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to upset you. She's like, no. This is amazing. She's like, I'm from a little town in Mexico, and we have a bridge in our town that's kind of like this bridge. And my boyfriend is back home in Mexico. And so at the end of every day after work, what we do is we go to that little bridge, and we just stand there and kind of have a moment. And that's kind of how we are together, since we're so far apart from each other. So I know that when he gets off of work and he goes and stands on his bridge, and then when I get off of work, I come and stand on my bridge. And I just sit here and I have a smoke and I think about my family back home, and you know, and then I'm crying, you know, like... And we like hug it out, and she's like, thank you so much for that. And I'm like, absolute, hold on, let me get you another copy. So now your boyfriend can have a copy, and you can have a copy of it.
Which, by the way, is great with the Instax, because you can just hit the reprint button on the side.
Exactly. Click, and out it comes. And kids love it. Oh my gosh, you're like a magician. So let's cycle. You can just click through.
So this, you do the double exposure on there?
Yeah, I was starting to play with double exposure. I haven't, you know, really been out there shooting.
Right, right.
None of us have, but the X100V has, I think you can shoot up now to 9 frames And they have blend modes that you can play around with. So I want to play around with that some more.
Yeah, it takes some playing. I played with it a little bit, and it there's a learning curve to it. So, yeah, but it's absolutely pretty interesting.
Yep.
I love this this movement shot of the boxing.
Yeah, so I like this as well, that we were a small group of photographers. We'd go around to certain things, and we'd spend time at different places and experiencing different parts of Havana. And boxing is really big in Havana. Just kids start boxing at an early age. And this boxing gym is just basically an abandoned lot between two buildings. And, you know, you shoot boxing pictures and you shoot the little action pictures of the kids. And I was, honestly, I was just getting bored of boxing pictures. We were there for a few hours, two or three hours, I think. And I felt like, I think I've gotten all the like boxing pictures, but I haven't gotten anything that shows the energy of these kids. And I didn't know how I would do that. So every now and then, you know, I remember like, oh, I could shoot slow shutter speed and kind of pan and let it get messy. And let's see what happens, you know? So I just dropped my shutter speed down. I may have clicked on the ND filter at this point, so I could keep my ISO fairly low.
Right.
And yeah, and just started playing. It's real hit or miss, no pun intended. But sometimes just slowing down that shutter, it, you know, for this, it kind of got that energy and the movement and the, you know, the back and forth, and then it gave it this like painterly color that I liked.
I was just gonna say, it's a very sort of abstract painting feel to it, and it looks like impressionistic or something. I like it a lot. This is the kind of stuff that I love to do with. I think as a storyteller, I think one of the biggest tools that we have as a photographer, storytelling, a visual storyteller using photography, is motion. Light is definitely a big part of it. But I think one of the things that a lot of photographers forget is to use motion. I mean, panning, slow shutter speed, fast shutter speeds, stopping motion, as well as blurring it like this. And don't freak out that, you know, that there's no real one super sharp spot on that image, because the whole thing works together as, you know, as one,
exactly
one image. And the other thing, which I know I'm sure that you use, is a rear curtain sync, and using motion blur with that, because then you do get a really sharp little spot on it, you know. And panning in using rear curtain sync, and that's where you can use your onboard flash, even on that little camera, and that really can make some really fun stuff. So yeah, this is really nice. Let's go on to the next one.
Yeah.
There you go.
So yeah, we got another boxing photo there. So this next picture coming up, the guy with the fence.
Oh, okay. This looks like there's a story behind it.
Well, a little bit. It's more of a story to illustrate something than it is a story in the actual photograph. But, you know, a thing about Havana and Cuba in general is the culture around these classic old American cars.
Right, yeah.
All these cars flooded into Cuba in the 50s. And then, you know, the curtain dropped and nothing else came back in. Mm-hmm. But they have maintained and kept all of these cars running, and through ingenious ways. Sometimes you'll see a 57 Chevy and it's got like a 2009 Hyundai engine inside of it. But you know, people are afraid it's cliche to photograph the cars in Cuba. And I say, to heck with that. Photograph the cars all you want. Like, shoot the car. Every single old car is awesome in Cuba, no matter what shape it's in. I love them. Well, and so I love to photograph those cars. And of course, you're going to shoot very cliched, you know, here's a picture of this, here's a picture of that, here's an old Pontiac, here's a old Plymouth, here's an old Ford, here's an old Chevy. Like, and it almost becomes like a catalog of pictures, like, you know, of old cars. I say shoot them to your heart's desire. I do the same. My favorite kind of thing to do, though, is either concentrate on little parts or pieces of the car, or incorporate one into the background or into the foreground of a picture, so it gives you that sense of Cuba. It gives you that sense of Havana.
It becomes a prop.
It becomes a prop, basically, yes. So I saw this frame. This was at the boxing gym. And the other photographers I was there with were all kind of concentrating on photographing the kids boxing. And I felt like I'd gotten what I wanted to get from that. And so I'm just kind of hanging out, you know, answering questions and wandering the few blocks around the place. And this yellow car pulls up. And I'm like, oh, my God, that car is so awesome. So I go and take pictures of the yellow car because, like, oh, it's a cool car. I'm like, oh, I want a different picture of this car. And so I was walking around and I'm like, oh, shooting through this fence would be cool, but it really needs a person. So this guy that's my portrait subject here, he's walking down the street. So I talked to him for a minute and, you know, I was like, would you mind hanging out right here while I take a picture of you? I just want to shoot a portrait in this area. And he was like, yeah, no problem. So, shot this, you know, few portraits of this guy, gave him the Instax print. And no joke, it was 10 minutes later, he was back with like four friends. And they all wanted, you know, pictures. That can sometimes be a problem with Instax, is that once you start handing them out, every single person wants them.
Zach. So one of the things that I've done, that I do all the time with the Instax, going back to it. And you know, I've told Fuji that Instax is gold, for photographers. You should make a deal where you package it with cameras because the Instax. So I'm in India. I'm working on an assignment, or I'm with a workshop in India. I'm photographing. I find this incredibly old man with a face that's just more wrinkles than the Grand Canyon, and I'm sitting here going, "Can I take your photo?" And he goes, "No." Mm-hmm. Go, oh crap! Please, no. Okay. All right. Fine. So I'm not one of these guys that sneaks photos and I don't do anything like that. So I go, okay, that's fine. And then there's a guy next to him sitting. I say, excuse me, can I take your photos? Yeah, sure. This guy is like completely boring. There's nothing interesting visually. I'm sure he's a great guy, but visually there's nothing interesting about this guy at all. Take a picture of him, print out an Instax. Yeah, exactly. So you print out the Instax, give it to him. And the guy goes, oh yeah! Wow! Oh, okay. Take my picture, you know. And now the old guy who had all the wrinkles wants his picture made. I mean, it is a secret weapon, and it is amazing. And I mean, I tout that thing all the time. So anyway, all right.
And it can, in certain cultures, it can save you money. So like in Marrakesh, in Morocco, when you're out shooting on the streets, everyone wants like a dirham or two, and honestly, I don't mind if, you know, someone's set up and they're sitting there and I want to take a photo of them and I'm talking to them and they want to, you know, a dirham or two. I'm not one of those. No, I'm completely pure. Right. I'm not on a National Geographic documentary assignment. I'm not, you know, a photojournalist in this moment. I'm just a dude walking around that wants to take pictures of people. And I can't make the pictures I want without the cooperation of, you know, the people I'm photographing. And in certain cultures, that if I'm getting the value of being able to take a photograph, they should have the value of being the subject. So we could talk probably forever on that, but you know, you can go broke pretty quick, handing out a dollar or two at a time. So Instax prints cost me somewhere in the range of like 70 cents if I buy them in bulk. And what I found is if I can convince somebody to let me take the picture first, and I give them a print. Like what you were saying just now with your story, is that anyone who sees that print in that area will then let you take a picture for a print.
Right.
And they're happy with the print. You don't. So it's cheaper in certain places in the world that you might find yourself to hand out Instax prints than to have a little roll of money, you know, in your pocket. I've handed out one print in a intersection in a market, and then everyone in that intersection let me take any picture I wanted, and I just handed out Instax prints. So back to this picture. Walked into a little church, and it was dark, and I had full confidence that the X100 can handle it. And what's beautiful again is it's so small and it's silent that nobody really pays any attention to you. You're just kind of another dumb tourist walking around.
Right.
And I love playing the part of the dumb tourist. I will be that dumb, stupid tourist who doesn't know anything all the time and just have a big goofy smile on my face and be nice to people. And you know, walking in this church and people are kind of having a moment, and you can snap a quick little picture and know it's not like clack, 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 right? Mm-hmm. Like mirror slap and all of that. It's
right.
Silent, absolutely silent. Let's continue on. Let's just kind of.
I love that. Here. I love this. I love the symmetry of this. I love the emotion with her lifting her hands up at the feet of Jesus. It's just full of, it's just. That's this is my kind of photography right here. So this is nice. Oh, this is now that's interesting. Tweety Bird and a baby held hostage.
Weird baby.
Yeah. What's the story behind that? Is there you just saw it in the street?
Yeah, I just saw it on the streets. There's a lot of folks that you know their job is to clean sweep. And sweep and you know keep trash off the streets. I think they make a little bit of money from the government doing this, but they also rely on tips, and those tips typically come from tourists. So you know they see it. Their job is to help keep the city clean and keep it nice for visitors and guests to their city, and then you know visitors and guests will. You know, give them a tip for doing a good job. So they just kind of roam the streets. I think they get a very small base pay, and then rely on tips.
Let me ask you a question. A little off the subject of the camera, but on photography. And you, this was a workshop you were doing and stuff. Do you find that and I'll phrase this as a question. Although it's really a statement. Do you find that many people when they're learning to take this kind of photography, in other words, sort of street photography or sort of documentary type stuff, they either focus on the wide shot or they focus on the portraits and they forget sort of the detail and the obscure a lot?
Yeah. I know that that's... That's very much the case in like my life as I go. I'll go on a trip and I'll take all these pictures and it's like what you say, it's a wide shot and it's a portrait, but never much of the details, you know? It's never much of focusing on some other part of a story that might be playing out. It can be too literal. Without any room for interpretation or asking questions or, you know, I think a good picture, not always, but a good picture is one that the viewer stops and wants to know more about it. Instead of a viewer sees the picture and go, okay, I see everything that's going on here.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it does.
Like I don't have to ask questions because I know what's happening.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. For me, the I always think in terms of story and narrative, and so for me, I look at something like this, or even a super detail shot, and I equate all these kind of, you know, wide, medium, close up, extreme close up. I think of these things as when you're reading a novel, and you go, the wide shot is the entrance to the chapter when he says the city was vast, and the author describes how big the city is, and all of a sudden that's a wide mm-hmm. shot, you know, and then he talks about the person being old and haggard or young and beautiful, and that's a portrait, and then all of a sudden they talk about the old rotten door falling apart or the hand touching the doorknob, and all of a sudden that's a detail shot, you know. And I think yep. that if we keep thinking narrative like that, and if we go, even when we travel, even though it's not a specific story, but it's the story of Cuba, and so as you go, you be sure to shoot the wide, medium, close up, extreme close up, and then you walk away with it, you know. So yeah,
all right. I'm gonna steal that. That is fantastic.
There you go. Okay, so this one.
You know, we can. I just don't have many specific stories behind each one. That,
okay.
I love the color of that last one.
I can go
but
back.
This one. So the couple on the bike.
Before you say anything, I'm going to say that I look at this and I think, and I mean this as a compliment. I don't mean this as but I think of Bresson. I mean, to me, this is Henri Cartier-Bresson. This could be in France. This could be in 1942. I mean, this is freaking amazing. I love, love, love this shot. Oh my gosh.
So
much I want out of
thank
there.
Thank you. Because I'm not gonna toot my own horn, but
you
once
love it too.
I pulled this picture up on my iPad and brought it to black and white, I was like, I can't tell where this was shot. This could have been shot 100 years ago in France.
Exactly. Right.
You know, it, and so we were walking to lunch as a group. So it must have been, I think it was 6 or 7 of us total, walking to lunch, and I'm chatting with somebody, and I always have my X100 just turned on. If I'm in the streets, it's always turned on. Mm-hmm. I never turn it off. It's always ready to roll. And I'm chatting with someone in the group, and we're just talking and da 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 da, and I'm into the conversation, and I see this couple coming our way, and I just yank my camera up, and as they're coming by, I just get one frame
right.
of them, and they were gone. Like, they're choop. Like, I didn't think about where my focus was. I didn't think about what my settings were. They just had this great look, and mm-hmm. the way she's like side saddle on that bike, and he was just very confident. I mean, she'd have a broken neck if that was me driving that bike. Like, and he's just like zipping along. And let me tell you, the streets in Cuba are just filled with holes, and curbs are all crazy, and there's cats and dogs running around everywhere. And like, and he's just like super confident. He's just zip, 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 zip down the street. And I just grab a shot. And I was like, wow, that I'd have killed myself trying to do that. Like, that was really great. And it wasn't until the next day that I downloaded this card into my iPad and was like, mm-hmm. oh, yeah, there's that couple. And I like, oh, I kind of like this picture. And it's kind of – it's one of my favorite pictures that I've ever taken in Cuba.
Yeah. I mean, it's just – it's amazing.
It was a total grab shot.
Well, and so that leads me to the next thing, talking about the camera. One of the things I noticed, so I just got back, very similar situation to you. I just got back, well, not just, in February, kind of your same timing with Cuba. I got back from India, and I was in Kolkata with the, I had the GFX, and I had the X100.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I took 2 pictures with the GFX, and everything else I took with the X100.
Yeah.
I fell in love with this camera all over again. I mean, it was just freaking amazing. I love this camera. So, which is why they had me do this interview, because they know that I'm such a fanboy of this camera. So, but the point is that I was doing panning with it. And normally, you know, when you shoot panning, you preset your focus, you go in manual and you know, blah, 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 blah. So, but, I went ahead and didn't do preset the focus on it. And I started panning with the focus point hitting the subject. And that thing focuses so freaking fast. The X100 mm-hmm. focus is like, bam, and grab it. And it, I mean, yep. It's so unlike this, which is the X100, the original.
The original.
Which I love this camera because it's a classic for what it is. But,
yep.
But you know, that and the X Pro 1, the focus on those two cameras were just horrendous. But yeah, this is just, it's just like, yeah, it's just nuts. It's just crazy. So I it doesn't surprise me you got it, but oh my gosh. I mean, the choice of doing this black and white, the frame on this thing, the composition, the leading lines, the even her hair being swept back and it's long, it's very 1940s. I mean, I could easily put this in a story on Bresson and everybody believe it.
A lucky shot, you know, such a lucky shot. Like sometimes you see somebody coming and you stop and you like prepare, and I didn't compose. I just stuck it to my face and shot a picture.
Well, it's one you can sure be proud of. That's for sure. Okay. Here we go. Oh, this is fun.
So there's just a fun picture. You know, just I like to show this picture just to show the reaction people have to having an Instax. They just absolutely love it. We can click on these next. Basically, you can just sort of cycle through these.
This is what you were talking about, details.
The classic. I shoot the classic chrome film simulation a lot. And, you know, there's no denying that camera manufacturers these days, they all make fantastic cameras. Like everyone, no one's making a bad camera these days. And, you know, the thing that Fuji has, everyone needs to have their own little niche. Like, you know, Sony's do this and Canon's do that and Nikon's are good at this. And Fuji, man, there's no denying Fuji color. Mm-hmm. The years that they spent developing Fuji film, what is mm-hmm. so interesting to me is that I've been to Tokyo, I've met with the different teams before, mm-hmm. and the very people who worked in the film division are now in the film simulation division. And so, you know, we're talking about people whose entire lives were calibrating and figuring out to the molecule of Provia and Astia and Acros as film, you know.
I don't think people know that. I don't think anybody knows that those are the exact same people that, you know, that did that. That's crazy. So that's nuts.
They worked on it on the cellulite level, and now it's on a digital chip. So what's amazing with Fuji is they're like, okay, our film is dying, but we have this team of people who has decades of experience in color and interpreting color and managing color, and they're down to the nth degree. Let's, instead of just giving them a retirement package and sending them out the door as the film, you know, mm-hmm. business shuts down, let's bring them over to the digital side of things. Let's pair them up with the digital engineers who, you know, have to do this in a computer instead of, you know, with petri dishes or whatever. And let's take these two generations of people, put them together and let's figure this out. And it, you know, again, you just, there's no denying Fuji color. Like, yeah. I know people who shoot other cameras, they shoot other manufacturer cameras, and they shoot them for a very specific reason. And if there's one thing they always say to me, say, but man, I wish I had that Fuji color.
Yeah.
You know? And it's just true. It's that Fuji color.
So was this shot in classic chrome?
Yeah, this is classic chrome. I may have punched it a little bit in post. I can't quite remember. But I love that. I wanted to show this picture because, I tend to be fairly shy and introverted, and I've much of my life had a very difficult time speaking with strangers. But the camera, I can hide behind the camera. I can introduce myself, point to the camera, and now the camera is the focus. The camera is the introductory tool. Mm-hmm. Hi, I'm Zach. I saw you standing here in your door. I'd like to take your picture. The camera is my introduction and is the reason I'm stopping to talk to you today, you know? Mm-hmm. And it opens up doors, you know? And I sat and I talked to this dude for a while and we followed each other on Instagram. He told me about his tattoo business and we kind of hit it off and chatted, and I asked him like, what kind of stuff, like if you could go to America and get stuff for your shop, you know, what kind of stuff would you need? And he's like, oh, I could use this and that and the other. I'm like, oh, those are all things that I could pack in a suitcase. So the next time I go to Havana, I'm going to pack up, you know, some of the stuff that he said that would really be helpful for his shop. You know, I mean, Cuba has changed so much for the better. It's unbelievable. I've been going to Cuba for 5 or 6 years now.
Haven't been yet.
It's unbelievable the changes that are happening that are for the good. But it's also still very difficult to get things at times. And anytime there's a hiccup in the world, if we think we have it hard where we are right now during coronavirus and lockdown, the Cubans have it like 10 times harder. So any hiccup in the world, they feel it more than we do here in the States. You know, somebody, I'm not saying that.
Yeah. Somebody told me that Cuba's getting to where you're tripping over tourists though. And especially in Havana, you're tripping over photographers and tour groups and stuff. Did you find that the case or what?
There are a lot, yes. And it's easy to avoid them because they have a very stereotypical predetermined sort of pathways they all go. Like,
right.
We're all going to go to, you know, this square at this time in the morning, and then we're all going to go to this square for lunch, and then we're all going to be at this spot for sunset. And you can see just a train of photographers and tour groups going in circles and circles. So it's also super easy to avoid them, to get off the path. The thing about Cuba is it's very safe. I've always felt safe there, you know, no matter what time of day or night, no matter where I went. I feel comfortable. So I feel comfortable getting off the beaten path in Havana and finding different stuff. And I prefer doing that wherever I go. Whenever I go to a new city, I'm like, show me the top five, you know, tourist destination spots. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to see Notre Dame. You got to see the Eiffel Tower. You got to see this. All right. Click, 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 click. Got those. All right. Now, where are the locals?
Right.
Where's the interesting places? Where's the gritty parts of town? Right. Show me something different. Oh, well, yeah, you got to get on a train and you got to take a train 20 minutes out of the city and you're going to go to this market. And, you know, the market is surrounded by a refugee camp at the moment. And inside the market, like, is all sorts of manners of commerce going on. Right. And, you know, packed with people. So, like, yes, let's get on a train. Let's go find this market up in the suburbs of Paris. What's really super interesting in Cuba right now is, so about three, four years ago, I guess, they started to open up these little small family-owned restaurants. Like, if you had a little place, you could start a restaurant for yourself, but it, only your immediate family could work there, and I think you were limited to, like, seating of 12 people. And there's a name for them. Paladars? Is it Paladar? I don't know. I forget. And it has grown and has grown. And the amount of private ownership of business that is growing in Cuba is growing and growing and growing. And now if you go to Cuba, you can sit in a pizza shop that you would swear that you were in Williamsburg in New York City, like down to the, everything is, you know, built with cool recycled pallet wood. They've got the awesome, like, chalkboard menu.
They've good or bad?
It's good. It's good because the world has moved on and the Cuban people have had to be stuck. Mm-hmm. For many reasons, and I don't want to get all into it.
Yeah.
But the world moved on. And then what I know I've been guilty of in my life is poverty porn.
Yeah.
To where I fly into Havana, everyone's living in abject poverty. The whole place is falling apart, but it's colorful and there's nice texture and the people are really nice. And so I get to go experience this really amazing place with amazing people. And I take all these pictures and it's like, look at these old dilapidated cars and these buildings are falling down, but look at the texture of it and look at the grit. And, you know, oh, those Cubans, they're just so kind and they work so hard even though they have so little. And then I hop on a plane and I take myself 90 miles to the north and we have every convenience in the world. We can walk into a pizza shop or a Chinese restaurant. We can go get sushi. We have all the options available to us. And my first few trips to Cuba was, if we didn't eat outside of the hotel or a government restaurant, then it was a ham and cheese sandwich on the corner. Like, you eat at your hotel or you eat ham and cheese sandwiches. And now you can sit in a poppin' rooftop bar having awesome drinks with great lighting looking over the city as if you're in any other Western city in the world, right? Like, so is it bad that you've got really great restaurants in New York? Is it bad that you've got these really cool, hip little places in Paris?
Yeah.
Is it bad that now Havana gets to have that too? And the beautiful thing, the beautiful thing that I saw on this last trip was that it wasn't just tourists in these places. It was everyday Cubans were also in line, were also hanging out on the rooftop. And that would not, I wouldn't have ever seen that 5 years ago. And it's everyday Cubans chilling out along with the tourists. Okay. And that, to me, I think is great progress. When you go to a place and all the great restaurants are only filled with tourists, there's some sort of disparity happening.
Yeah, there's something wrong.
Where the locals are serving you, but they're not sitting next to you. And that was really great to see on this last trip to Cuba. And they're able to build their own businesses and make money and support their families like they've never been able to before. And I fully love that. So I, you know, I'm cynical and like, I don't want to see a Starbucks on every corner and, you know, go to a McDonald's. Those aren't there. So hopefully it all stays local and keeps their local charm. But you can't stop the marching, you know, tank of
progress,
American exceptionalism, and try to put up Burger King on every corner. But
right.
Yeah. Yeah. Anywho, that's my last picture right there. Just random last picture of the car. Yeah. Should we hit some questions?
Yeah, if people are out there and asking questions. So we're at we're getting close to 2 hours, so we probably need to start wrapping it up anyway. But while we start wrapping it up, listen, I need to do a little commercial break. And so what I'm going to do right now is tell you that I would love if you would like to hear more of these interviews, either with Fuji. By the way, Fujifilm Malaysia is really excited to have Zach with us. And we also have all kinds of other live stream that we'll be doing in the past. We've done. They're all here on Fujifilm's Facebook page, as well as in the future. We have a lot more ready for you and in store. And then I'm kind of taking over the Fujifilm come back here and go here. There. So I've sort of taken over the Fujifilm Facebook page for tonight. And so I wanted to, because I've got you, I want to say I would love to have you sign up to my mailing list. And if you are interested in knowing about any of the other interviews and workshops that I have going forward, please feel free to sign up to the mailing list. And when you do, you'll get this ebook called 25 Tips, Tricks, and Gear Suggestions for the Traveling Photographer. And in it, you will have all kinds of information about taking a pop-up background with you, how to back up your stuff on the field, even the type of clothing to wear when you travel with a camera, even to the most obscure thing like traveling with coffee, because I love coffee. And then I give you a packing list on that I use as well. And if you're interested in that book, you subscribe, you go to thedigitaltrekker.com, and that's how you spell it, and that's how it's done. Hit enter that, and then you go to it'll take you to this page, and this is you will simply, all you have to do is type in your first name, type in your email address, and then hit subscribe. And then once you do, you will be taken to a page to download the ebook, and you will be told about what's happening in the future every time I do an email. So those people that that have subscribed, they knew about the interview with Zach and everything that was happening with him coming up. So that's it. And so if you've got a question for us, we'd love to hear from you right now. So I do have one, Zach. So let's come back here. And let's see. Kevin Sen says, or Calvin Sen says, is all the pictures taken in RAW format? And you said they weren't, right? Because you didn't have any kind of a RAW converter at the time.
So everything I've shot with the X100V to date has been RAW plus JPEG, and everything that you've seen are the JPEGs coming out of it. Mm-hmm. The reason I shot RAW plus JPEG is because I was specifically shooting for Fuji.
Oh, I thought you were going to say. I thought you were going to say because you use your Instax, because it doesn't print off of the RAW. So that's true. Why I shoot RAW plus JPEG, because I use the Instax.
Here's my big. This is my big controversial statement that I'll say, is that whenever I travel, and I'm just like walking around taking pictures, or I'm doing street photography in a city, or if it's not a job, let's say for a client, then I just shoot JPEG, and I have the function button on the lever here. I have that set up so that it will jump over to RAW plus JPEG. Hmm. If I come up to a situation where like it's a sunset and there's just this huge gradient of color in the sky where I know that, you know, in those gradients, the JPEG might find some banding. Then I'll pop it to RAW real quick. But 99% of what I shoot when I travel or when I'm on the street is JPEG.
Interesting. That's really interesting.
I don't need 18 terabytes of random ass pictures, you know, is which I take lots of random pictures, you know. From this trip in Cuba, I can think of probably three pictures that I would say I want to print and put on my wall, you know, like three of them out of the hundreds.
One of them is a girl sitting on a bicycle, hopefully. Huh? Right.
Yeah. Yeah. That's one of them.
Yeah.
And, you know, now I like the pictures and, you know, they'll, I don't know where they'll go. Right. Like so many of my pictures just sit on a hard drive somewhere. Like I don't publish books of my work at this point in my life, and I don't have gallery showings of my work. I don't do exhibitions. I'm not a travel photographer, so that I'm constantly being published in magazines, and you can see my walls are empty. I really want to start printing my travel work just to put up in my own house. But I know that maybe in 10 or 15 years, you know, I might have a body of work that I want to do a book, or I'll have a body of work I want to do an exhibition or something. Maybe there'll be a theme. And I'm fully confident that a JPEG out of this camera is all that I need to make beautiful prints.
Do you find the dynamic range on the X100? I mean, is it significant? Is it good?
I think it's great. You know, it's you know, I don't get into like DxO scores and all of that, so
I don't mean that, but I just mean the sense of like if you underexpose something, can you pull it up and recover?
Oh yeah, it's always held together. I've always been surprised of how much I can recover either out of highlights or shadows. Of course, the RAW will always hold more information, but yeah, the JPEGs are fantastic.
All right. Well, if you got another question, we got let's give ourselves another couple minutes before we head out, and we'll let Zack start his day. But if you don't, then we can call it quits. I'm looking over here at my here we go. Let's see here. Bill Kate says, "Would you mind letting us know how you process this webcast equipment used and everything?" Okay, I tell you what, Bill. Thanks. Appreciate the comment. If you'll hang on when we close in a few minutes, I have credits, and it tells you all the equipment that I use on this whole webcast. And thank you for that compliment. That's very kind of you to say so. Okay, I have a list over here of things I wanted to make.
It looks really great.
Well.
This is a very professional setup you've got here.
You're very kind. Thank you. Well, only the best for our friends at Fuji. So, so let's see here. So, let me see. We talked. Hey, did you notice that they got rid of the? I didn't even notice this. This is how you were talking about how you didn't notice the flip screen. I was in prepping for this interview. I was watching some videos and stuff, and I didn't realize that the mode button is gone.
Display mode.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got into some situation where I had bumped it. So by default, some button changed it that I didn't see. Something happened. And I was trying quickly to get it out. And I'm like, Where's the mode button? Where's the mode button? Like where'd they hide it? Why is there not a
gone.
Mode button on this? I'm a little perplexed, I think. If I were to give any feedback or critique of the camera as like you couldn't put a mode button on it, like, but you know, it's
It's funny. I never use mine. I mean, I get it set to what I want, and pretty much that's always that way. I use the ideal-y thingy bobber.
Yeah,
that's it for me.
And I'm like that too. But there are times that I'm wanting to switch things back and forth. But you can always set any of the function buttons to the mode change. And that's, I have mine set up so when you push the rear dial, it will cycle through the mode changes.
Okay. All right.
For the viewfinder.
Okay. Yeah. And then the other thing I want to talk about, and I need to switch over to my overhead camera here. So, and you can stay in frame here. I want to talk about, so I actually put an extra lens hood on here. This is the square lens hood. It's called square hood. Mm-hmm. Gosh, I love this thing. But anyway, one of the cool things, and this isn't a commercial for these guys. I'm going to do a review on them. But what I want to talk about is the weather sealing on the camera. So this camera now apparently is weather sealed, weather resistant. But you need to have the adapter, right? So you get the adapter, and if you see there, I've got a adapter that square hood uses. Oops, sorry, that square hood uses. And then a UV filter, a Hoya UV filter, mm-hmm. and then all that screws on, and it gives it a. Now it's interesting. Fuji doesn't say how much weather seal this is, to what degree, but
right.
But I mean, I've stood in rain shooting, and it's been fine. But that's a. So you can get the additional part of that on this, and which is unique to the V. You know, the other ones didn't have that. I mean, they had a
right.
You could take that off and put a UV filter on it and everything, but the camera wasn't weather sealed for that. So,
yeah, I'm really glad that they've brought a level of weather sealing to it. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't either.
To what end? And the way I carry mine is on a black rapid strap. So when it's on my side, it's usually pointing, it's kind of upside down.
Right.
And I wonder about this little speaker grill here, how, if water got into that. But, you know, I mean, I take care of my equipment, but I don't treat my gear with, you know, kid's gloves.
Right.
And I've had my previous X100s in the rain before, and they've gotten wet. Only once in my life have I killed a camera, or it didn't kill it, but it definitely sent it to the shop. I had a Nikon D3. Love that camera. Still one of my favorite cameras I've ever had. And I was shooting, and it started raining, and I was taking pictures, and then it started pouring. Like torrential pouring.
Okay.
And I had to get this picture. The torrential pouring made the picture better. And I knew that, like, I may kill my camera. Like, this, it may go to the shop, or it might just be dead after this. But
and it did.
Hell with it. Here we are. And so I kept shooting. And sure enough, I kept shooting until it just, like, gave me error messages and shut down. Threw it in a bag of rice for a week. Still gave me all the error messages. Wouldn't shoot. Wouldn't fire. Sent it to the shop, and it was like $400 repair. They had to fix something. But
ouch.
So, you know, like, I take care of my gear, but like, if I'm walking around and it's raining,
it's a tool.
Yeah, you know, I don't want to drop it in any water, but I do like that it has some level. I don't know what level, but some level of protection.
Well, I'm with you. I'm with you, Zach. I mean, to me, these things, they're tools, and they're tools for trade. And I don't know of any carpenter, any home builder, that treats his tool, that abuses his tools, but he Correct. Uses them, and they use them hard, you know, and because they use them, they get dinged up, and sometimes they break, but they use them. And that, to me, that's the way I look at these cameras. I mean, it's hard. These cameras are sexy. They're beautiful, but they're still a tool. And so they're going to get in the dirt with me. They're going to bounce around in a bag, get knocked in another camera and some lenses and things, you know, and it's just the way it is. Okay. One
I like it when my cameras get a little brassing and, dinged up. And
well, I wish they had brass on these. That
do you
would
know
be
Kevin
really
Mullins?
Cool. Yeah.
Out of the UK?
Yeah.
Man, you should see some of his cameras. Like, there's no paint left on the body. Like, I don't know what the hell he does to his cameras, but he pulls them out, and I'm like, that's been through a war zone. Like, nope, just weddings, which similar.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, my stuff gets dinged up because I'm usually, you know, laying down in front of the Taj Mahal or someplace trying to get a shot, and it's, and the camera's being knocked up against something or something. So
yeah.
Anyway, I was gonna talk about one last thing, and then it's exactly 10 o'clock. So we've been talking for two whole hours. I didn't plan on it going this long, so I appreciate your time. And we can maybe, hopefully we can do this again. Although I probably said that last time we talked, which was 10 years ago. So maybe we'll talk in another 10 years. Anyway, do you have anything going on? Do you have any workshops happening? What do you need to, I'm going to give you some time to pitch anything. What do you got going? Anything?
Okay. If I want to pitch anything coming up, it's Friday already. So this will probably be next week. I am doing a fire sale of all of my education products, my One Light Workshop videos, my ebooks. It's going to be a $5 sale. Like, everything's $5. And yeah, so that's going to be next week at deadpixel.com, deedpxl.com. No, my favorite workshop that I'm running right now has had to be postponed until next year, because of the travel. So, right. All my workshops are canceled or postponed until further notice.
So it was Dead Pixel, DEDPIXEL. Is that it?
No, DEDPXL. Yeah.
PXL.
Yes.
All right. I'm going to put it up on the screen here, but I'm having a hard time. DEDPXL.com.
Yes.
Right? Okay. So it's that right there, right? DEDPXL.
It's really pixelated on my end, so I can't.
Well, it's DEDPXL. There's no vowel in pixel.com, right? Okay.
Correct.
And then the other thing is, I have your I'm gonna go to full, oops, that was a goof, here we go. So full screen, I'm gonna show your site is zackarias.com. people can visit your work there. Your YouTube is used film. YouTube.com/usedfilm. And then if people want to follow you on Instagram, it's also used film.
Zarius.
Oh, Zarius. Oh, sorry. That's the wrong one.
Sorry. I need to get everything. I'm bad at branding because I started all of these things at different points in social media world, you know?
Like, okay.
They're all different ages and not everything was available. Yeah, it's a
all
mess.
Right. Well,
but check out my YouTube channel. I've been making a lot more content.
You've been doing a lot on that.
Dormant.
So.
I was dormant on YouTube for 3 or 4 years, and then about 30 seconds before quarantine hit, I'm like, you know what? I'm going to start making content again, and then we all got stuck at home like immediately. So it might be my fault. Maybe I shouldn't have done that. So I've been making content, and I've got a couple videos coming out this week. Come hang out with me on YouTube.
Okay, so I'm gonna try this. I'm gonna try this one more time. So it's zackarias.com, YouTube used film, and then Instagram.com Zarius. So it's
Zarius.
Zarius, right?
Okay. Correct.
Cool. All right. So there it is. And Zack, thank you so much for just being with us and hanging out.
Absolutely,
And I appreciate you taking the time. I know it's been a while here. So I appreciate the time that you have taken with us. So all right, so we're gonna head on out. Oh, we got one last question. XT3 or XH1, which is the best? That's a matter of whatever you're shooting, right? Whatever you need it for. You need video, XH1.
Right. I never owned the XT3, but I have the XT4 now, and my son Caleb has the XH1. Mm-hmm. And he's thinking he's going to sell his XH1 and get an XT4. He does a lot of video. And so I know the XT4 has taken a step ahead of the XH1. So that makes sense. It's a newer camera.
I was going to say the XH4 is taking a step ahead of everybody. I mean, that thing is incredible. I mean, it's doing stuff that $100,000 cameras are only doing.
So yeah, I've only had it for a week, so I haven't really dove deep into it yet. But I know my son, who does a lot of video, he lives in Dubai, and does a lot of video with the XH1, and he's all hot to trot to get the XT4, because none of us know if an XH2 is on the horizon or not. I never know what's happening until I get an email saying, hey, we have it. Right. Do you want it? So XT3, if you're at XT3 or XH1, XT3 for stills, I think, and XH1 for video. And if you need both equally, then I'd say XH1, because the XH1 is still a very capable stills camera. Tit for tat. I would just go the XH1 specifically for the video capability.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, thanks again, Zach.
Image stabilization on the XT3.
Go ahead. Go ahead. Yes. Finish it. Finish
Thank
it.
Thank you for the question.
Say. No. Finish what you're gonna say. The image stabilization.
That in-body image stabilization on the XT4, I'm like, holy shit. That is it's like a tripod.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's built differently. The whole physical part of that camera is different. It's much more DSLR-y feeling and stuff, and it's bigger. If you like a bigger camera, mm-hmm. then you're gonna love that XH1. But if you came to Fuji for the small little cameras like I did, that XH1 it's a different thing. You know, it's a different bird. So
agreed.
But if you're doing video, then you're not gonna be worried about size, because you're gonna put all that other crap all over it and put the little thingy there and the thingy there and that little thingy there and everything. So cool. All right,
all
Zach,
things.
We got to let you go, and we got to let people here in Malaysia go as well. So appreciate your time. Appreciate everything.
Thank you, Matt.
So so we'll talk to you real soon. Okay.
All right. Thank you, Malaysia. Thanks, y'all.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye. Mm-hmm.